He told Shimon's brother Reuven last night when we spoke, do me a favor, when we get to Olam Haba, you and your brother will have two seats, and I hope you're going to have one chair between both of you for me. Make sure you keep one for me. So he told me, what do you mean? You're doing it way before us. So I told him, no, that's not the way it works. I am a one-man operation. Whatever I do, I do. Whoever becomes religious, I have a schut. But they have, how many, 40? How many rabbis by now? 40 rabbis are working for them full time. Yeah, they maintain the website, Baruch Hashem, with your help and whoever helps. As a part in this very great stock. People are expert in stocks in a market here in New York. You buy it here, tomorrow you won't take it to the grave with you. Over here, you take it to the grave with you. Yes, forever. It stays by you forever. It's interesting, because you know, now, if you're really aware of the news, what's going on in America, this country is not doing so well. I don't know if you're aware of what's going on. And the reason I bring it up, not that I care so much about politics, but politics is life. You cannot ignore it. Ignore it, tomorrow they catch you not surprised. So you should know the rules in Jewish history. It's like this. Whenever the goyim in the country that the Jews are living are not doing well financially, the first one who pay the price are the Jews. Always been like that. Unfortunately, always will be like this. Therefore, in this country today, it's the major place where the Jews live. We have about, I don't know, 5-6 million Jews at least lives in America. There are much more than that that don't even know that they're Jews. But I'm talking those who knows that they're Jews. Maybe 5-6 millions, a lot of them here in New York, LA, see a lot of Jews here. They are going to be the one who will be on a highlight now. Why? Baruch Hashem, the Torah says that the Jews are naturally blessed. That everywhere they go, the Torah says, Vayita sham lemashal ulishnina. Rashi writes, everybody will speak about you and be impressed by you. Then in another place in the Torah it says that Jews that sticks to the Torah will make a Kiddush Hashem. How does the Torah say it? Ve'yomru am chacham ve'navon ha'goy hazeh. This nation is very bright, thanks to the laws of the Torah. And you should know that we contributed to humanity more than all the nations together, in any field, not only in religion, in any field, in physics, in math, in science, in novels, in everything you want to call it, except sport. Sport, it's not for us. Why? What's the difference between us and the goyim when it comes to sport? We, when God created the person, he put in his nature, in his genes, the nature of a person is that he needs war. He needs to fight in his life. He needs to fight. Where to fight, it's the free choice of the person to decide. We supposed to concentrate our habits to fight against our evil inclination. The goyim don't care about their evil inclination. They learn to live with that. They're pretty good friends. They go together to the bar to drink. They do all kinds of things together. One love the other. One help the other to continue to think. We are afraid of the evil inclination, so we have to do everything we can to fight against them. Since we are busy fighting against the evil inclination, we don't have too much time to fight in different fields. The goyim, since they don't have who to fight, they invented something called sport. What sport? Sport, it's an illustration. What's the right word for that?
Metaphor,
I'm not sure, but you know when they train the jet pilots, they put them in a special simulation. Yeah, that's the right word. So the goyim wanted to go into a war. They don't want to really kill one another, so they made up a sport. They do boxing, basketball, soccer, football, all these things, and they give their life for it. They cry when they lose. They scream, they run on the streets when they win. One rabbi, his name is Rav Eliezer ben David, I once heard him sing in the yeshiva, interesting word. He said, I've been in Argentina. He has yeshiva, perhaps in Argentina. And they say it was evening, and it was many years ago. And then in the middle of the night, somewhere like around late night, he heard such a huge scream from all the houses in the neighborhood. What do you think? An atomic bomb just fell somewhere, you know? And he asked the owner of the house, what happened? He got nervous. We told him, no, Rabbi, Argentina is playing against another country and somebody just scored a goal. So a normal Jew would say, ah, Baruch Hashem, no tragedy happened. We can go back on our life. But he sat on the couch and started to cry. Why did he cry? Because he said, those nations that have nothing in their life, their religion is false. Their way is all phony. Nothing that they do is according to God's wish. They live in illusion. For 2,000 years they invented themselves holidays and lights and a lot of flashy things. And they have no background, no solid foundation. They scream like this. They get to a level like this that they're so fanatic about something. Why we that have the truth are not so fanatic about the truth? You know, I started to tell you the situation in this country becoming very bad. Until recently, until September 11, this country was on the top of the mountain. Everything was great, financial, real estate. You know, there was no serious war. United States was in charge almost of the whole world. Come a bunch of Arabs from the desert that learned 2 weeks before how to fly a plane. They knocked down the Twin Towers. Of course, the damage is, the Twin Towers is not the main damage. You know, $20 billion is nothing for a country like America if that would be the only damage. The damage is mental, psychological, such damage that in 5-6 years since then, nothing here is working. And we are paying the price. Not only us, every American citizen, everybody in the world suffer because of the nation of Ishmael, that they brought this on us. It's a part of the plan, as you read in the prophecies from 2,000 years ago, that before Mashiach come, Ishmael will have control in the entire world. Physical and mental control. Full control. They control the oil. Everybody has to beg them if they want to produce more oil. They're not. They do whatever they want. They're taking over now all the banks in America because nobody else can buy those banks. They are the only one who have hundreds of billions of dollars. They don't know what to do with that. The bracha that Ishmael got from the angel when his mother threw him in the desert, he gave him bracha. We suffer from this bracha until today. Not only that, that the Brit Milah that Ishmael made brought him a lot of good points. Their father did few good things in their life. They get paid now. They get paid. We have to suffer. It's always like this. The Zohar says, when Israel is up, Ishmael is down. When Israel is down, Ishmael is up. We are down now. We are down. Israel is falling apart. We lose against the war between them. They win against us even though they don't really have an army. It's just groups of militants, you know. They win. Already 20, 30 years they're beating us. But the worst part here is now, remember my words here, it's recorded today. We are in December, what, 5th, 6th today? 5th. What, 2007, right? Remember this. Hopefully people will see it in the next few months. They'll see what I say here today. This country is on the way down big time. Big time. In less than a year, you will see what's going to happen here. And what's the sign for it? When I was in LA 2 weeks ago, I met a nice Israeli guy, 27 years old. He was thinking for a while. He started to keep Shabbat, put tefillin. He goes to some lectures here and there in LA. There's not that much like here. Here people are spoiled. A little bit snow, 90% of the people go to bed. Yeah. Over there in LA, when finally somebody comes, it's a big celebration for them, you know. Oh, there's a rabbi in town. So he goes to lecture here and there, and that's it. Just about it. So I convinced him. It wasn't so easy. It wasn't so difficult. Pretty easy. Usually it's much harder to convince the guy to leave what he does and come to yeshiva to learn. But with this guy, he has a good heart. It was maybe 15 minutes. We shook hands. He's coming to the yeshiva. We agreed that on Sunday he's going to come. He said, listen, I'm illegal here. You know, my visa expired after 6 months. I'm here already more than 2 years. I can't take a risk getting on a plane. You never know in the airport, immigration. So I may come with my car. So I said, well, whatever you want, as long as you get there. He said, yeah, I made a AAA to make sure I won't get stuck. I'm driving from LA. Then he started to calculate, it will cost me more gas and tolls than to just take the train. What do I need it? I'll sell the car and I come with the train. Sold his car. He decided to come. Then in the last minute, he said, I cannot come this Sunday. I will come the following Sunday. Why? My friend needs a help. He's a painter. He doesn't have anybody to help him. He needs to paint a house. He told me if I can stay and help him. I told him, no, it doesn't pay to lose another week of Torah, to just go make a few $100. Tell your friend to get a Spanish guy, Mexican guy in L.A. You have millions walking on the street. They're looking for a job. Let him get a Spanish guy to help him to do the job. What does he do? No, but I gave him my word. I saw that's it. I cannot now argue with him. Maybe it's my fault. I should have argued with him. But in the end, I let it go. I say, okay, you want to come next Sunday? Come next Sunday. Next Sunday, he gets on the train. He takes the train. He stops in Chicago. He calls me from Chicago. I'm getting to New York tomorrow night near Madison Square Garden over there. That's the station. I check in my computer. I found him a bus from there to Spring Valley. Everything was said that I'll pick him up from the train. Thursday morning, like a knife in the heart, I get a phone call 9:30 in the morning. Rabbi Yosef, what happened? I'm arrested in Pennsylvania. What happened? I was sleeping on a train. Immigration agents getting now on trains, like in Nazi Germany, getting on the trains, checking one by one on the trains. Something like this in a country like this is a big thing. They check one by one. Somebody woke him up. Hey, you have an ID? Let me see your ID. Show them the passport. They look at the visa, the stamp. You're here more than 6 months. Handcuffs. Take him to the station. He calls me up from the station already now in Pennsylvania. He let me speak to the officer over there. The officer says, sir, we need an address where to send the suitcases. If within 30 days we don't find an address where to send the suitcases, we destroy them. That's the law. You want to accept it? I say, yes. I give him my address. You know, I'm nervous. You have to think what to do. I said, what's the reason you arrested him? You never know. You know, you meet Israeli guy, you can have some drugs in his pocket. So the guy said, illegal alien. He's beyond his visa. So for something like this, you arrest people? He said, sure. It's a big thing. What are you going to do with him? We're going to transfer him to Erie County Jail in Pennsylvania. For how long? Until he's going to see a judge that decide to deport him to his country. In the meantime, he gets to the jail. They take his tefillin away. I call up the jail. No, but 5 different people I call, they don't even know what kosher food is. They don't know. Never heard of the word kosher in their life. 5 different goyim in a jail. You believe such a thing? The one in charge of the diet, of the food in the jail, he said, we don't have any special diets here. If he's vegetarian, if he's vegetarian, he has a problem. I say, no, he's not vegetarian. Kosher, you don't know kosher, religion. He doesn't know anything. I say, no, not here. We have one diet here. Okay, now no tefillin. There's nobody to talk to. Now, from now on, you cannot talk to the guy. I started to make phone calls, use all my connection, everything that I could get. We even got to the White House, to Washington. Believe me, I'm not exaggerating. I found a rabbi from Brooklyn, a friend of mine that knows a rabbi from New Square that know a very big, big shot that with connection with Clinton and all these people. We got to Washington. What's the answer? Immigration? There's nothing we can do. Nothing we can do. It's like another government, immigration. They have the right to do whatever they want. How long they going to keep him there? 1 month, 6 months, whatever they want. No law, no rights, no lawyer can come, nothing. Mamash, like unbelievable, like they do to the prisoners, the terrorists. Where they put them over there? Where is that? In what country? You don't know what they do to him now. It's full of people there. You know, it's terrible now. So what's the message from this story? Number one, it doesn't pay to stay illegally here. Parnasa, there's no parnasa here. No parnasa here. If you don't have papers, what kind of job you get? Just to eat. You might as well stay in the Holy Land. There's no parnasa here. Used to be parnasa here. Now there's no parnasa. Second, if they catch you, it's $1 billion. If you had, you would pay to get out of there. You would see the way the guy was sound on the phone. I was trying to encourage him not to, God forbid, to do something for himself. That's it. Say, so you don't know what's going on. Metal, bed, so many goyim around me, noise. Forget it, no privacy. You gotta go to the bathroom, excuse my language, you gotta do it in the middle of the room when everybody see you. There's no doors, no nothing. And now, this is the biggest joke here. That's why I'm telling you why this country is going down. When your brain don't work, the entire body suffer. You heard that? Every day, the immigration pay the jail. It's private jails. Thousands of dollars for each illegal immigrant that they put in jail to keep him there. When they could have just catch the illegal immigrant, maybe give him a penalty or something and release him that day. Put him on a plane and send him back to his country and save about $100,000 on each prisoner. They have tens of thousands of prisoners all over the country. The immigration don't have their own jails. This is what I learned in the last few days, what's going on here. And they pay thousands of dollars for every day that they keep them there. And they keep transfer them every 2 weeks to a new jail. Why? This is something new. I didn't know that. Every 2 weeks they transfer them to another jail. Why? To make more money. It's all mafia. The jails is the biggest mafia here. They transfer him to another jail because the registration and the medical check and all that thing, it's another few thousand dollars to get from the government. Then they wonder what's going to happen in this country when they lose so much money in Iraq, when nobody has money to pay their mortgage, when people cannot pay the food anymore, so many poor Americans. How long this lie will stand? In the holy language, there are two words. Emet and Sheker. I'm sure you heard that before. It's worth to say it. That's the time for it. Emet, it's the truth. Aleph stands on two legs. Mem stands on two legs. Tav stands on two legs. Sheker, it's the lie. Shein stands on one leg. Kuf stands on one leg. Resh stands on one leg. What we learn from that? That the truth is solid. It has strong foundation. It's not shaky. It stands straight. It's not crooked. It's not moving. It's always going to be the same. The lie is standing on one leg. How long a person can stand on one leg? One minute, 10 minutes, 20 minutes, then he falls. So it's temporary. Plus, emet, aleph start with the first letter in aleph bet, mem, it's in the middle, and taf, it's in the end. From the beginning of the world until the end of the world, there's one truth, and it's always going to stay the same truth. That's the Torah. And the sheker, shin, kuf, resh. It should have been kuf, resh, shin. So first of all, the order is mixed. It's not in the right order. To show you that the people that live in a lie, they confuse themselves. Every day when they wake up, they don't know what they're going to do today. What they're going to choose to do. They have no goal. No targets. You don't have targets, you don't know direction. You don't have direction, you lost. So they do not know where they're heading to. They're not aiming anywhere. Only one target, to make money. What? That they have more food. For what? That they live better. It's going to be more delicious. Before you realize your life is over, how long are you going to enjoy? Chazal says when this life is finished, and a person looks back in his last Gilgul, his last reincarnation, it looks like a blink of the eye. Keheref ayin. You know what this means? Keheref ayin? That half of a second that the muscle of the eyelashes relax and you blink, that's this life. That's how long this life is. People ask this question, if God knows the future, where is our choice? God already knew before this world started how it's going to end. He already knew, each one of us, what mark we're going to get when we finish. He knew if I'm going to be righteous or not. So in that case, what's the point of this? I understand. I read in the Torah says you should choose the life. It's all about you. Be careful that you won't get punished. If you do the right thing, I reward you. You and your children after you. There are many words in the Torah that shows you without a doubt that it's all in your hand. Free choice. Whatever you cook on Friday, you eat on Shabbat. Right? You heard that sentence? Mi she'tarach be'erev Shabbat yochal be'Shabbat. Someone who put an effort before Shabbat to cook the right food, he will have what to eat on Shabbat, right? So everybody that reads that thinks, well, you cook on Friday, you have what to eat on Shabbos, you have chulen, no? But the truth is, that's not what it means. Okay, for this you need Torah. But in Puerto Rico, they don't know. In Santo Domingo, they don't know that if you cook on Friday, you have food for Shabbat. Saudi Arabia don't know, they don't have Torah. They know anyway, no? The meaning here is, if you prepared in this world to the world to come, you're going to have what to eat over there. The fruit from the trees that you plant here will stay forever for you to eat from it. Spiritually, it's all spiritual. David HaMelech writes in Tehilim, Zorea tzedakot matzmiach yeshuot. Listen to the words. Zorea means plant in the ground. Zorea tzedakot, plant charities. Many different charities. What's the rest? Matzmiach. It grows. Yeshuot. Salvations. It saves you later on when you need those, whatever you plant today. Now, I want to ask you a question. When a person plants seeds in the ground, it costs money, right? There's a lot of work. A lot of efforts. He needs to water it. There's a lot of work until finally you have an orange tree. It takes years. You have a good tree that you can eat now the oranges or the peaches, whatever you planted. It takes time. But what's so great about the trees? That it's on continuous basis. It'll never stop. Every year for thousands of years, it will continue if you maintain the tree right. All you did is you put the efforts once. You put it, you put some water, you work a little bit, then you leave it and it continue to produce fruits and reward forever and ever and ever. Comes the Torah and says, you put charities, you plant charities in the ground, you plant charities in your life in different places, you go to Olam Haba, they continue to produce profit for you on a continuous basis. And Chazal says, someone who bothered this world and prepared himself to the world to come will have what to eat over there. I want to start reading to you a few of the words of one of the greatest Kabbalists that live in history. He lived about 250 years ago. His name is Rabbi Moshe Chaim Lutzato, the Ramchal. I don't have the time to tell you a little bit about his life story, because when you hear about his life story, it's hard to believe that we had people like this only 10 generations ago. Hard to believe. All I can tell you is that he died age 38. And in very short life, he wrote many, many Kabbalah books, philosophical books, and he discovered to Jewish people in the world a lot of the secrets that they were not sure about, in a clear way, speaking mainly about the purpose of life, explanation about certain things that happen in a creation, and the goal in life. And this is how he starts his book. The name of the book, you can get it with English translation. It's called Path to the Just. It's in Hebrew, Mesilat Yesharim. Very classy book, famous book. Every yeshiva has it in the world, all over the world. It's called Musar. This is the way he's starting his book. In the introduction, he writes like this. Amar Amchaber, says the author, this book I did not write to teach people what they do not know. Only to remind them what they already know. Remember, this was 250 years ago. Today, it does not apply. If he would write it today, he wouldn't write this introduction, because today you have more than 80% of the Jews that don't know one thing of their life. You ask them, what are you doing here? What's your purpose in life? What's the difference between you and a chimpanzee in a jungle? He doesn't know. And I already told you in one of the lecture I made a comparison between a person and a dog or a person and a monkey, and we all agree, not you, maybe different crowd, we all agree that it would be a million times better to be an animal than to be a human being. No suffering, no 30 years mortgage, no subprime crisis, no immigration, no trains, no planes, no life insurance, no yeshiva tuition, none of these things. You don't have to work a week in order for you to have food for 2 days. You know, today what's happening in America, people that wants to go from one place to the other, let's say from Staten Island to work in Brooklyn, by the time they get there, they pay the tolls, they pay the gas, they pay lunch, breakfast, and dinner, that's what they made that day. And I'm not exaggerating. And I know people like this. I have a friend from Muncie, he goes to yeshiva in Brooklyn. He makes $800 a month from the yeshiva, and it costs him $450 the bus. Yes. I said, what are you doing? Why are you wasting your time? He said, I have nothing better. I check all over. Can't find. That's what he does. Lives in a little room. That's the situation. It would be much better to be a chimpanzee. Wake up in the morning, jump on the trees, have fruit, coconut, throw it on people's head, playing with the females over there, have five different wives. Doesn't have to worry about vaccines, doctor appointment every 2 days. I need you in the house. What? Doctor appointment. To which one of them? Before you came back from one appointment, you have to go to the next one. Back and forth, back and forth. Teacher-parents conference. You finish with one, you came back, tomorrow you have another two. Sometimes you need to share yourself to five different bodies to do just what you have to do in the house. Those animals don't have it. Plus, they're not depressed. The main problem, it's an epidemic already, depression. For every 10 people you see, few of them are depressed. They're not happy from their life. Somebody told me about an owner of one of the biggest communication companies in the world is a Jew that tried to commit suicide a few times already. He has billions of dollars in cash in his account, billions of dollars. He has thousands of employees. Religious person, religious, tried to commit suicide already a few times.
Jewish?
Yes, Jewish. Jewish religious. Couldn't believe that story. I said, depressed, all the time depressed. Depressed. Let's see what the Ramchal say. I did not write it to teach you what you don't know. I only want to remind you what you need to remember every day. Most of the things I wrote here, people know. They're famous. Everybody heard about it. But because they are so famous and they are around all over, people got used to it and they're not getting excited from seeing it. They just take it for granted. They learn to live with that. And he says, that's why you have to read this book all the time, not once. Because if you're going to read it once, that's it. You'll forget about it. And you will forget your obligation in life. Now, let's jump to the first words of his book, chapter 1. The foundation of a chassid, of a righteous Jew, the foundation, to start. If a person one day decides, that's it, no more games. I don't want to be a goy anymore. From today on, I want to start fulfilling my mission in life. Until now, I wasted 20, 30, 40, 50 years. Today, I had a guy came from New Jersey to the yeshiva. He saw me sitting on the side there reading something. He came to me. He said, can I learn with you? I said, yes. Only with one condition. What? That you're going to let me tell you the truth about you in your face. He looks at me like this. I said, no, it's going to be strong. You may not like to hear it. So he almost left. But his curiosity got him to sit. I saw him with a hair like this. I started to attack him for 3.5 hours. Non-stop, with no mercy. And then after 3.5 hours, he said, first time in my life I didn't smoke a cigarette for 3.5 hours. Every 10 minutes I light a cigarette. I don't know how I made it. He said, So I told him, I hope you're not offended. You know, everything I told you is for your own good. He was complaining about his life. He's not married, this, work, problems. Then I started to talk about certain things, and I told him, I'm going to say the problems, and you tell me if I'm correct or not. I started to talk about anger, jealousy, laziness, this, that, this, and he was honest guy. Yeah, you're right. So then in the end he says, so now that's it, I'm finished. With this list, where do I start? I gave him a few books, I say, here, take those three books, go and start. Yeah, but I don't understand, it's a hard language. It's really hard language, it's an ancient language. A lot of those words Israelis don't use anymore. You take a professor in the Hebrew University, you bring him to me, I show you he doesn't know how to read. Guarantee. Professor in a university teach hundreds of students every year. You show him to read without dots, without nekudot, he writes wrong. The language of the Rambam, few times it happened. So read, so many mistakes in his grammar, mil'el, mil'ra, he doesn't know grammar. Why? Torah is one thing, what they learn is another thing. So the Ramchal writes, now pay attention, maybe you heard it in the past, but not in the way I will present it right now. Pay attention to every word, it was word for you to hear it. The foundation of the Hasidut. People think Hasid is someone that has a beard, nice black hat, and peyos 20 times a day. He goes like this, right? And he moves like this. That's Hasid. Oh, Hasid. Goes to the mikveh every day, Rabbi. That's not Hasid. The Ramchal doesn't call people like this Hasidim. Let's see who is a Hasid, real Hasid. Yesod HaChasidut v'shoresh HaAvodah, the root of the work of a Jew in this life, the perfect work, is, pay attention to the orders, שיתברר ויתאמת אצל האדם, that a person will clarify without any doubt what is obligation in this world. You understand? When someone asks you, I want to become religious, what is my first step, Rabbi? What's my first step in life? The answer of the Ramchal is that you clarify what's the purpose of your creation, what you have to do in this temporary world. Why God put you here? For sure He didn't want you to eat and drink and sleep and have just a wife. The animals have it. You're different than them. So that's first thing. And he's continuing, ולמה צריך שישים מבטו ומגמתו, and what he has to pay attention and his direction בכל אשר הוא עמל כל ימי חייו. He is going to suffer and to work a lot, work very hard in his life. He has to make sure that he doesn't waste his energy in the wrong places. He will have to focus and use the energy, the ability that God gave him, to use it for the right target, for the right mission. Otherwise, he's going to lose big time. He dies and he will suffer for eternity. Why? He's going to find out that the opportunity that he had got lost. Then, Chachamenu taught us, our sages from generation that received the Torah from Moshe and transferred it from hand to hand, told us that a person did not get created, he got created to enjoy the sweetness and the pleasure of God Himself, which is a pleasure, it's a real pleasure, larger than all the pleasures that exist in this world. In another place they said, if you take all the pleasure of this planet, combine them together, it will not be equal to 1 second of the reward that a righteous Jew will get once he leaves this materialistic world. It pays to work or not? For eternity. What's eternity? Do you ever think about this word, eternity? A billion years, it's not the beginning of the eternity. People ask, I started to say before, God already know my end. Why do I have to bother? You already know. It's over before it started. What's the answer to that? Who knows?
On one hand, we see that God warned us in the Torah so many times, be careful not to go in the wrong direction. Be careful not to make sins. Be careful not to lose. Make sure you do the right things that I should reward you in your end. That's the words of the Torah. Comes our common sense and say, wait a minute, God, you claim you know the future. I believe you. You knew in the moment you created me what's going to be my end. So where is my choice, right? The answer is pay attention. A few days ago, I got a phone call from Brooklyn, a friend of mine in Brooklyn, and this is what he said. I have a deal with a guy from Florida. A deal. Handshake. Handshake, by the way, it's a final agreement in the Torah when you shake hands. You bind it to it in court. If two witnesses saw you shaking hands with a guy, I owe you $100,000, you have to give him the money. It's like signing a personal guarantee, handshake. It's not a joke, handshake. So, he said, I have a handshake with this guy, that if we answer him his question, he's going to start keeping mitzvot right away. I cannot answer him this question. It's a very hard question. Maybe you can. So I make a conference call. Can you answer him this? I say, yeah, what's the question? Let's see. He asked me this question. I told him, and that's the truth, this is one of the most, perhaps the most famous question in history. Not only the Jews asking this question, the Goyim also asked it, the Muslims ask it, Christians ask this question, the Hindus, the Buddhists, every normal human being with common sense asks this question. Everybody with his knowledge understands God knows the future. And if God knows something, that will have a way to get to a different place, he already knows. So he asked me this question. The answer to this question, the Rambam writes, is larger than all the oceans. If you take ink, size of how much water you have in the oceans, how much water. Imagine you have a pen with so much ink. You write and write and write for billions of years. You don't finish the ink. So much water, 72% of the world is water. Just imagine, you have to write with the amount of ink like the oceans. The Rambam says, if you write the answer to this question, it's like the size of the oceans, and it still will be hard to understand. But instead of wasting a million or billion of years of learning and trying to calculate all the possibilities, why do you want to give yourself a hard time? Just go by the bottom line. What's the bottom line? God says you should choose the life. Be careful not to choose the death. Be careful not to be wicked. I'm warning you. I will benefit you. I will punish you. All these words are saying what? That it's all in your hand. If it wasn't in your hand, what's all this warning? What's the Torah for? Why God sent so many prophets to warn us? That's the final answer of the Rambam. But I have a way to explain it. But you have to focus on the next 2 minutes on every word I say in the right order. We, people, are temporary. See, you hear? Why you hear? You know why you hear? Because it's a bunch of molecules, material, temporary. It's going to be here 70, 80, 90 years, and it's over. It's going to become sand, finished. Once the soul gets out of the body, you're going to hit the hand of the soul. The soul has the same image like the body. You won't hear anything. It will go on empty. Till tomorrow, you go like this. There's no material. But it's the same person. You go on empty like this. Now, maybe when I go like this, maybe I could just chop someone's head. But you don't hear it. Because it's a soul. It's an energy. When you tell your wife, I love you. I missed you. I'm sad today. I'm upset. I'm angry. I'm happy. All these words, it's the soul speaking, not the body. With or without the body, all these things are still exist. I'm happy. Without the body, you're happy. You understand what I'm saying? Those feelings, those language is all 100% spiritual. God never ever been physical, never ever been material. Since he was always here, and it does not depend on time, he was never depend on time at any given time. He is endless. He's for eternity. He cannot get killed. He cannot be limited to a size or an image or a color. Or he doesn't take special space. He's all over. You cannot hide from him. Every corner, every closet you're going to try to hide is there. Everywhere. In the good and in the bad. Every piece of sand, God is in it. Every star, everything, every piece, drop of water is in it. There's not one place in this creation or other creations that God made that is not a part of it. Everything is here. Now, when God created us, the name of God is Yud, Hey, Vav, and Hey. Right? Why? It doesn't make... There's no meaning to this word. In Hebrew, you have Nekudot, you know how to read. You don't read it the way it sounds. I mean, the way it's written. You call it in a different name. You don't read it Yud, Hey, Vav, and Hey. Those four letters are a combination of the three times. Past, present, and future. Haya, Ove, Viye. Comes those four words, Yud, Hey, Vav, and Hey. You can write with those four letters three different times. Haya, past, you use the Hey, Yud, and Hey. Ove, you use the Hey, Vav, and Hey. And Hiye, which is what's going to be. With four letters, you can conclude all three times. We, as people, right now are in the present. A minute ago, it was the past, and what's going to happen in the next minute is the future. Every combination of everything we're going to do in our life, it's connected directly to time. There's not one thing that we did since the moment we created and put in a body that we did that did not have something to do with time. It's all connected to time. When you eat, when you sleep, when you talk, when you walk, when you learn, whatever, everything you say has the time in your words. There is no way to understand what you speak or what you do by separating it from time. It's all related to time. When God, it's the opposite. It's not connected to time. And now, this is where we have a difficulty to understand. When God created us, in that millionth of a second when He created the world, from the beginning of the world until the end of the world, the Torah says 6,000 years. And it's over. For God, the 6,000 years that are future to come already happened and finished in the second that He created that. How? He can travel in time as much as He wants. He can go a million years forward, a million years backwards, 1,000 years, 2,000 years. He can be at any given time, it's simultaneously, at the same time. How can you understand such a thing? There's no way to understand. Why? Because when you have a computer, when you program your computer with Windows, and you want now the computer to work with a different software, the computer will not work. You press until tomorrow, the computer doesn't understand what you want from him. You try to explain your computer for 5,000 years what to do. It won't help. Until you're going to take from the hard drive that program and put a different one. Same thing, your brain. You are programmed from the minute of your creation that everything you understand and do relates to time. There's no way for you to understand something that does not relate to time. There's no way for you to understand. The same thing like you take a blind person and try to explain him the color blue, how beautiful it is. You waste a month, it's like the sky, it's like the ocean, it's so relaxing. It's shining, you know, it's a little bit like green. You talk until tomorrow and he doesn't understand what you want. You show him blue one time, now you explain him, he knows what you're talking about. You don't have a way to understand it as long as you're in a physical body. Once you get out of a physical body, you will understand it. Why? Because you'll be a soul. A soul, it's divine. It's a part of God Himself. Every Jewish soul, it's a spark from God Himself. Chelek Eloah Mimal, Chazal writes, him, me, her, all of us, it's a part of God. Each one of us. And this eternal soul that we have, it's for eternity. Why? Because God is eternal. Now here comes the answer. When God created us, there was really 6,000 years ahead of us, and we will be reincarnated in many bodies until we reach our final goal. We have opportunity after opportunity to correct. Some of us needs to be reincarnated again and again and again. That means we losers. We fail in our previous life and the previous one and the previous one. And we have another test and another test and another test. Like when I was in school, my teacher, after a few tests, he said, listen, don't waste my time. Don't waste your time. I'll give you 60. Leave me alone. Every week you come, you fail, you know. So you know what? I'll give you 60. 60 is good. Your father will let you go with that. Leave me alone. This is it. We fail again and again, and we come again in another body and another. And each body is designed according to who you were in your previous life. If in your previous life you were a proud person, pretty lady, she try to get attention everywhere she go with her beauty. She does bad things with her beauty. In the next life, God puts her in a face that is not so pretty anymore. Now you have to correct. Everything the opposite, or sometimes the other way around. Now she's even prettier than before, because now her test is even harder. In her previous life she failed, now she has an opportunity again to correct, to be modest, not to attract attention. That's why you have the laws written. So for God, this is the way it works. When He created everything, it was set in their chronological order 6,000 years. And everything is free choice. Whatever we're going to do, we are deciding. The only difference is that we cannot jump ahead. We cannot jump 500 years forward and see what we're going to be in our next body. We have no ability to travel in time. But He, since He does not depend or limited to time, He is in every time, which is hard for us to understand. Try to understand anyway, even though it's hard. He already saw the end of it. But until we got to the end of it, it was 100% in our hand. The only difference is that He has such a giant step, we make little steps. He takes a huge step, and He got to the end, and so what happened? Now He takes reverse one step, and He's back to square one. When He look at the end, what happened? We still didn't get there. For us, there's no future yet. Tomorrow will be future. Right now, there's no future yet. The next second will be the future, but we're not there yet. Understand? So we are in a slow motion, and He is already there. That's what we cannot understand. You created here, and this is your end right here. Your test, all combined, is from here to here. But your Creator, when He created you here, is already here already. At that second that He created you here, He already finished. For Him, it's all over. You understand? It's like a video. Fast forward. You see the video in 20 seconds, but it's a 2 hours video. You rewind, you play with that. Imagine there was a person that traveled ahead, forward, rewind, as much as he wants. But you are living from second to second. And I asked that person, he's in Florida, I told him, let me ask you a question. If I give you an envelope and I write everything you're going to do from now until tomorrow night, and I put this envelope in your pocket, and I tell you, open it tomorrow night. Don't open it until tomorrow night. I'm going to write everything you're going to do from now until tomorrow night. And tomorrow night when you... So the morning he wakes up, he says, no, I have an envelope here. I wonder what he wrote about me. He knows me that I'm wearing always black pants. I'm going to trick that guy. Today, for the first time in my life, I wear a jeans. He went, he got a jeans of his brother. He wore a jeans. So now for sure he doesn't know. Then he ate this, he changed his diet. Everything he could, he did to trick me. At the end of the day, he opened up the envelope. You wear a jeans, you ate this, you ate that. Everything I knew. So I asked him, did I affected your choice? Or you chose whatever you wanted to do? You thought what you wanted to do and you did. So no, you're an external power. You're out of this picture. So my ability to know your future, it's only because I have a power that you don't have, that I can foresee the future. But that doesn't mean I went into your brain and moved you left and right. And this is what the Rambam writes. The Rambam writes, don't ever let it cross in your mind, or enter your mind, I should say, to say what the ignorance of the Jewish the ignorance of the non-Jewish people, and Rov Golmei Bnei Israel, Golem. You know what a golem is? It's like a raw material that was never developed into anything. So it's not really a fool, but it's something similar, golem. ורוב גולמי בני ישראל אומרים, don't ever say what other people say, that the future of the person was pre-decided for him. Everyone has the right to be righteous like Moshe Rabbeinu or wicked like Yerovam ben Nevat. It's 100% in his hand. And that's why the Torah gave all these warnings and all this punishment. If you're a robot, who can punish a robot? I'm moving with the remote left and right, then I'll give him a punishment because he fell in the stairs? I moved him. He's a robot. No, he's not a robot. That's why you have jails everywhere. How do you know that from the minute of the creation until today, every person in the creation believe in the concept of a free choice? How do you know? Police and jail. That's the proof. You know any country that there's no police and jail? If you know a country that they have a rule not to have a police and jail, then maybe they don't believe in a free choice over there. When you find that country, let me know. To the best of my knowledge, every town has a police in the entire world. Even in Africa, the police dress a little bit different or don't dress at all, but it's still a police. There's a sheriff, the head, he is a judge. He decides who to punish, who not. Back to the words of the Ramchal. So the Ramchal says, the purpose of the creation of the human being, which means the soul, was to give the soul divine pleasure. Now I want to ask you a question. Let's use our head, common sense. Can you point on one person in this world, one person today in the world from 6.4 billion, that every second of his life enjoying a divine pleasure? Can you point at one person? Most people, 99.99999% of the people are miserable. Depression, poverty, divorce, never got married, don't have children, problems with the children, financial problem, bankruptcies, problems with the partners, problems in traffic every day, sicknesses, all kinds of mental problems, so many problems, friends suffering. Finally, you are perfect. You have no problem. Your brother has manic depression. I know a guy like this. Say, wow, if I wouldn't have this brother, my life would be perfect. Say, but nobody's life is perfect. That's why you have this brother. If you have this brother, you have a different problem. You ever order furniture? Brand new furniture. When the movers bring it, you're so excited. Wow, what a nice dining set. When they leave, you always find a scratch. At least one. Why? Because God planted from the day he created the world that this physical world is a lie. It will never be perfect. Don't love it so much. It's temporary. That's why the Shin Kuf Resh stands on one leg and in a wrong order, and it's only limited. Three letters from 22 letters, one after the other, in the wrong order, and it's over. But the Emet, from the beginning to the end, stands on two legs. The Ramchal continues and says, no pleasure in this world, all of it together, cannot be like the pleasure that God really gives the righteous people. Where is this pleasure? Since we don't see it here, final conclusion is that this pleasure is in the world to come. And the creation, which is us, needs a preparation for the place which is going to receive the pleasure. And this is our final destination. And that's the only reason we are here. We have to go from here to the end of our life and earn the credit. And once you go there, you cash on your merit. You owe me, give me. Pay me. I paid my dues. Now it's your turn to pay. If you don't have, you come there, you're empty. The Ramchal continues and says, this world is a hallway to the final world, an entrance. And the credits that a person can get to enter there and to cash out his reward, this beautiful pleasure, is the Torah and the mitzvot. This is the key. You want to get the key, you want to get your credit card charged, there's a way to charge it. Torah and mitzvot. You can charge it in a different way. This is your charger. And the place of acting and doing the mitzvot is only in this world. Over there, there's no mitzvot. That's why the person was put in a body here first, in this world. To prepare him for the final destination, which is eternal. And over there, there is no end to his reward for the little that he did in this temporary life. When you review carefully what I just said, you're going to see that the only way to reach perfectness is to get closer and closer to your Creator. To be stuck with him like crazy glue. Glue. Davuk bo. Dvekut. Where does it say it in the Torah? Where? You hear it on Shul, on Shabbat. Maybe you don't know what you're saying. Ve'atem ha-devekim ba-Hashem Elokechem, chayim kulchem hayom. Those are the one who are glued to Hashem. What glue? Went to Home Depot and got crazy glue and glue yourself to God? What does it mean, glue to your God? Dvekim, tabuk. Find me a better word in English. What's a better word of a strong connection? Cement. Maybe cement. Huh? Every one of these words is partially truth. It's not, you don't have in English the right word. Devotion, maybe. I'm not sure. So, Atem advekim, that's the problem when the language is human, it cannot replace a divine language. Remember what I said, that professor, the Christian professor? I wrote to him a part from Martin Luther, not Martin Luther King. Martin Luther, the original, from 500 years ago. Teddy, of course not. I sent him an email. I told him 3 out of 50 question answer. Now I send him an email. I had a new email now. Somebody sent me an email 2 days ago, very interesting email. In Houston, Texas, there was a church with 100 members, Christians. One day, their priest retired and they received a new priest. And that new priest, for months, never mentioned anything about JC in the church. And they keep asking him questions about JC. He changed the subject. He speaks about the Old Testament only. One woman started to suspect something is fishy here. So she told him, listen, you know, this is not a typical church here. You know, every church I've been, they speak only about JC. Since I know you, I don't remember once you told us something about him. Then he couldn't hide that anymore. So he told her, I'm in the process of converting to Judaism. She told him, what do you mean? He said, I found out that the New Testament is false. Too many contradictions. She said, how did you find out? He said, I read a book by Rav Aryeh Kaplan. Remember him? He mentioned that book. He mentioned that book. Why Jews refuse to accept JC. So he said, after I read that book, common sense. Why can I go against the truth? I see that it's not the word of God. Why should I go to a phony religion if I have the valid religion? Slowly, slowly, all the 100 members over there started to convert. Some of them converted fully to Judaism, completely. Some of them decided to become righteous goyim and keep the 7 laws of Noah. It's in Houston, Texas. If you want, give me your emails. I'll send you that email. It's interesting. All of them, I sent it to him, but I didn't send it to him from my email because I don't want him to bother me with their nonsense. I sent it to him from a friend of mine. But he doesn't know who he is. I tell you, you know, they're so good with their speeches. Dear brothers and sisters, speaking and saying, what's the feelings? My feelings don't let me now change after 31 years. You fool! Now it's the time to change. Before, it's going to be too late. The pride. What, 31 years I grinded water? 31 years I'm grinding and grinding and it's the same water? Yes, so what? It's painful. It's like a Jew that just found out that after 20 years he's feeling he's missing a row, a line. Pasul, 20 years, every day comes to shul, puts tefillin, sits, shtayim mikra achat targum, learns with the tefillin. Ah, what a tefillin I got. I paid so much. Mistake, human error. Found out after 20 years his tefillin is not kosher. So a fool is continuing to put that. No, it's kosher. A smart person buried them in the ground and buy new ones. with all the agony and the pain, 20 years you did not have any zchut of tefillin. Whatever the reason is, it's only Hashem knows why. It happens to righteous people, not only to bad people. I remember once my neighbor came out with his tefillin in his hand, and there was the garbage truck. And they just passed his house, and they came to my house. And he was running with his garbage. In one hand he had the tefillin, and in the other hand he had the garbage. So he came. So he came by mistake. He saw me. He wanted to say hi. He threw the tefillin and the thing into the grinder of the truck. So he said to me, you know what? For a year I'm thinking to buy new tefillin, not to buy. Because this tefillin, everybody that sees it makes fun at me. Little mchukmak tefillin like this. So he said, now I got my answer. I told him, I made him feel good. I said, for sure they're not kosher. Don't worry. Now it's the time you get a kosher tefillin. You never know. Anyway, we'll go back to this. Pay attention carefully, because every word here is the word of God himself. It's not that Ramchal one day decided to write nice palm here. Pay attention to every word. And he continued to say it like this. The only way to reach perfectness is to stick to Hashem Yitbarach. Advekut. Hu ma sha'ya David ha-melech omer. This is the word of David, King David. Va'ani kirvat Elokim litov. All I want in my life is to be close to Hashem, not physically. Physically, Hashem is everywhere. Everywhere you're going to stand, you're close to Hashem. Even when you're in a bathroom, you're close to Hashem. When you're sleeping, you're close to Hashem. When you walk in the street, you're close to Hashem. You walk in Sodom and Gomorrah, you're close to Hashem. Hashem is everywhere. Some places it doesn't like to be. What can we do? We made it not so pleasant for him to be there. Like in mixed weddings, for instance. Shekhinah disappeared. Of course, Hashem is everywhere, but the Shekhinah, there's something holy called the Shekhinah of Hashem, doesn't come to these places. And where does it say it in the Torah? V'ra'a becha ervat davar v'shav me'acharecha. Every place Hashem see problems with modesty, the ladies are not dressed properly, parts of their bodies are open, automatically the blessing and the Shekhinah of Hashem disappeared from that room. That's why people have to be very careful. Sometimes they make a wedding, and because of their guest, the Shekhinah doesn't come to the chuppah, because the people under chuppah forgot to get dressed. We continue. Achad shaalti me'et Hashem. People read Tehillim, they think they read the New York Times. It's better to read 2 pages of Tehillim, but word by word, and pay attention to the words, than just to read 20 pages without thinking about it. Because the purpose of Tehillim is to purify your soul and your mind. Once you read this word, it opens up the heart. If you pay attention to every sentence in Tehillim, it's mamash unbelievable. Unbelievable.
What about people who are doing Sefim, like Tikkun HaKalil?
It's also good. It's 10 chapters from Tehillim.
What if you have 15 minutes set time for prayer every day?
Chazal says like this, I answer you. And my answer applies to all the questions you have. It's better a little bit with attention than a lot with no thinking.
So if you want to do Tikkun HaKalil, it's better to do one of the Psalms within those 10 with intention than to do all the 10 to make sure that you've done it.
Yes. It's better to think about the words. If it takes longer, let it take longer.
In English, or does it matter?
Well, if you don't know Hebrew, you do it in English. Always do in the language you understand, English, Russian, whatever it is. But I always tell people who ask me these questions, the answer is when a person pray, he has to pray in the language he understand. But he cannot stay until age 70 until he learned to say 2 sentences in Hebrew. It's an obligation to learn Hebrew. Now, how do you learn Hebrew? When you learn Torah, you learn Hebrew. Automatically. We had people in the yeshiva from Venezuela. After 2 years, they arrived from Venezuela to New York. 2 years later, while they're learning Mara and Halachot, they learn already Hebrew through the yeshiva. Now, when a person has the prayer in his sidur, he can take a pencil and write above the words. Today, we have already sidurim that have it in 2 languages. One above it, they give you the translation. But he can write with his own handwriting. He takes a person that knows Hebrew, that translates all the words of the prayer, and he writes it in Russian or in English above. And like this, Even if he doesn't know the language, at least he learned only the prayer, what they mean. So then he can say it in Hebrew, not understanding really word by word, but literally, I mean, he knows about what he's saying, what he's requesting. Now I'm praising God, now I'm praising him this, now this, now... He knows what he's talking about. That's already good. Now...
If you want to recite the Tikkun HaKvari, and you can only do one psalm with intent, and you do it, is it considered from heaven as if you recited the whole Tikkun HaKvari?
Yes, because you know how it goes? Every mitzvah that a person does when it comes to learning, it goes by time. You learn 1 minute Torah, 2 minutes Torah, 3 minutes Torah. Now every one of us has a different brain. What your brain can catch in a minute, your friend next to you can catch in 10 seconds. So he learns 5 times faster or 6 times faster than you. But that doesn't mean his reward is greater than you. Because it goes by the efforts, you understand? Therefore, a person that put efforts, based on the efforts, this is how much his reward. There was hundreds of sources to back up what I just told you. I'll give you one. When Avraham Avinu saw the angels coming to him, he did not know they're angels. He thought they're Arabs. Now, Avraham knew as a person that has a hospitality, he has a motel, he takes care of people, he feeds them for free. He only requests that they'll make a bracha, that they bless Hashem. Three Arabs come, three goyim, they come and they want to eat, and Avraham runs and slaughter the cow and bring them the tongue and mustard and all, and making breads and bringing water. Running around like crazy just to satisfy 3 foreigners that he doesn't know. Really, what came out of Avraham Avinu? Anything came out of this mitzvah? The angels couldn't eat. Angels don't have stomach. It was just an image. He thought they are real people. But they're really angels. They were pretending that they're eating to satisfy his feeling. But really, the angels did not enjoy from this whole meal. This whole meal was a waste of time. But Avraham, God rewarded that his descendants got man from heaven, bread, thanks to the bread he made them. We got water, thanks to the water they got from the well. Hashem gave us a well that walked with us in the desert for 40 years until Miriam died. For the meat that he gave them from that cow, we got slav. Chazal brings every act that Avraham did for those Arabs, angels, we got 40 years of pleasure, the descendants of Avraham, thanks to this mitzvah. Measure for measure. Even though nothing came out of his mitzvah. It was a waste of time. You understand? Even though it's true that a person has to do his best to know where to invest his energy. If you see a religious person or a non-religious person, and you have $10 to give charity to one of them, and usually when you see two religious people, you give 5 and 5. But when you see a religious person or a non-religious person, you don't want to give the non-religious person. Why? Because he's going to take your $5 and put gas in his car and drive on Shabbat with your money. So not only that you don't get any reward because you gave a person that you saw that what he's going to do. If you didn't know, if he has yarmulke and he's a phony person, it counts for you, you did the right thing. If you see he walks without yarmulke, no tzitzit, his peos is cut above the ears, you see right away he's not keeping Shabbat, this person. You gave him money, you had mercy on him. You think you're helping him, but you're really ruining his life. Because without your money, he had to stay home and not drive. Now with your money, he drove for an extra hour on Shabbat, another 60 million sins he made, which every second of it is karet from the Torah. When it comes to Olam Haba, he will never stop to curse you for the $10 you gave him. Why? Why did you give me the money? I wish you wouldn't give me the money. I would have less punishments now to get. But that's not the way people think. People go with their heart, like that guy that was standing here. My feelings. Torah is the truth. Feelings, feelings. Feelings get us nowhere. What's the feelings going to help? Right? Person fell in love with Goya. The Torah says she'll bury you. It destroyed your descendants. No part of the world to come. She's tied to him like a dog with rabies, you know? Cannot get rid of him. Yes, that's what the Chazal say. Kshura bo kekelev. But Rabbi, she's such a good woman. You know, I was in hospital. She took care of me. She was there from morning to night, 20 hours. Beautiful. Buy her a nice gift. Send her a $10,000 check when you win the lottery. I can't sleep at night. I fell in love. Fell in love.
feelings. Shaul HaMelech went once in his life with his feelings. He had mercy on Agag. You heard about Agag, the king of Amalek? 3,000 years later, 6 million Jews were murdered because Shaul HaMelech had feelings. And Shaul HaMelech was a righteous king. Don't get me wrong. Gemara says because he was a modest king, he has Esther, his descendants, plus many other things. In life, throughout history, when the feeling overcomes the thinking, usually it brings a destruction. This is almost always. Always. Now, don't get me wrong. I didn't say you have to be cold as ice. No more feelings. No, my heart is on strike. That's not what I said. But you have to make sure when there is a contradiction between the truth of the sentences of the Torah, the text, or the text of the Gemara, or the Shulchan Aruch, or Chazal, or Rashi, or Rambam, whichever one is going to be, to your heart, put your heart for 5 minutes in the garbage. Until you do the right thing, then bring your heart back and put it in the inside. You should also know, when you ask in a Torah, who is a chacham? Who is a smart person? Right away you say, somebody with a sharp brain. He knows math, he knows computer, he knows physics, he's a great doctor, he's a great lawyer, he's a great speaker, he has great memory. That's a smart person. Gurnish. Beloni. All this is a person with qualities. Who God himself, the creator of wisdom, who God's call a wise guy, a smart person? Read in the Torah, Chacham Lev. That's the expression. A person that he's a Chacham, his heart is smart. Heart? Heart is a bunch of molecules. What's heart? You go buy, in Israel they sell hearts of chicken, hearts of the cows, $9.99 a pound, a kilo over there. Yeah, hearts, they sell hearts. Not that it's good to eat hearts of the animals, but it's kosher.
Shlomo HaMelech was actually, when he was asked the question, he said he wanted Lev Chacham.
Lev Chacham, very good. Lev Chacham, Bezalel Ben Uri, Hashem says Chacham Lev. Why the Torah doesn't get impressed from the intelligence in the head? Because you can be like a parrot. You see it, you learn. A parrot, everything he hears, he repeats, right? It's called Chamor Noseh Sfarim. You see it all your life, you read, you know. You're not a hero. You know what's hard? Chazal says, Ezu Agibor Akoveshet Yitzro. Let's connect it together. To have it in the brain and not move it into action, you're worthless. That's why you're wicked. You're worthless. Rabbi, I know all the Torah by heart. Sometimes I used to go to lecture people that when they were kids, they were in yeshiva, they learned the parashot by heart. I'll tell you everything you want. I was in L.A., there was a Yemenite guy. Every time I start to say a pasuk, he finishes it. But he drives on Shabbat. What's his knowledge brought him? He made his hell even deeper. Because when you're ignorant, you have something to defend you a little bit. Not that it's going to help a lot, because God will ask you, why are you ignorant? Don't you know that in Judaism, to be ignorant, it's a crime? It's the only religion that when you don't know Torah, you are a criminal. And that's right there explain you that it's the word of God, the creation, the creator. The creator is very upset if you don't learn in his knowledge. Why? That's why he gave you the knowledge. If your father bought you a beautiful car, after so many years of efforts, he bought you the car that you dream about. And you never even bother to sit once in it. You don't care about it. I don't like the color. I don't like the car. It's cheap car. What's your father going to be? Upset, no? If your father gets upset, it's needless to say, Hashem gave you such wisdom, the Torah, and you put it on a shelf. Rabbi, I have all these books in my home. You come to his home, it's like Sifrutek. Brand new. The tag is still on. Yeah. Now, the Ramchal continue and brings David HaMelech. Achad sha'alti me'et Hashem, ota avakesh. I have only one request from you, God. Ota avakesh, shivti bebet Hashem kol yemechayai. Allow me to sit in Torah lectures in the yeshiva all my life. You may say, what do you mean, David HaMelech? You're the master of universe, what? King David? All the goyim admire him. Such an unbelievable person.
He prays to Hashem and he writes in Tehillim. How do you know that he's not lying? Maybe he just praised himself. Maybe he's just bragging. Maybe inside his heart he really wanted money and fame and whatever the king, other kings want. How do you know? If it would not be the truth, God will not put it in the Tanakh. It's a sentence from the book of God. It's in the Tanakh. Tehillim, it's a part of the Tanakh. After that debate, I ate my heart because I had maybe 20 or 30 different sources. I gave him a source from the Torah, but I could give him a lot of sources from Tehillim. Only when I got home, I thought to myself, what a fool I am. I could have get from the computer right away maybe 20 different sources that in the Tehillim, God promised the Jews that the Torah is eternal, forever and ever. Not only the Shabbat is for ledore dorot, and the circumcision is forever, because he wanted to claim that the Mosaic Torah is not relevant anymore. It was up to a certain time, and then it's expired. But there's so many sentences in the Torah that it says, l'chao levanecha ad olam, ledore dorot. I gave him from the Torah, but in Tehillim, almost in every chapter you have it. So many, and they believe in the Tehillim. They believe in the 24 books of the Bible, Tanakh. They claim this is the word of God. They know. You ask a Christian guy, King David, is him or is God? It's God speaking. Same thing they claim, the New Testament, they believe in Tehillim. Tehillim, I have it so many times. Maybe in the next debate, in the next life. But anyway, אחד שאלתי מאת השם, if Hashem would not agree, if Hashem knew that David המלך, he's thinking different than what he says, he wouldn't be in Tehillim. He would prevent it from being a part, an integral part of God's book. It's part of the Tanakh. Then we continue and saying like this. ראוי שיעמול האדם, and a person should put all his efforts to gain this dvekut, that glue, to get stuck to Hashem. לדבק בו יתברך בכוח מעשים, שתולדתם זה העניין והם המצוות. The more מצוות you do, the more Torah you learn, the more prayer you pray, your glue, your cement becoming stronger and stronger to Hashem. The less you do, it becomes weaker and weaker. And it goes by a second. That minute you learn Torah, it became stronger. What's the proof? One time I gave a lecture in Or Natan, the first Or Natan. Or Natan had three reincarnations. The house, 108 Street, and Queens Boulevard. And the first, in the house, Baruch Hashem was a small place, that's why it's always packed, you know. But over there one time, I started to speak about charity. I don't know, it wasn't planned. Speaking about something else, I don't know, somebody said something, and somehow I shifted the whole lecture to charity. Maybe 10-15 minutes, I speak very strongly about charity, for Torah, for poor people who learn Torah, what is chut, what a stock you buy for yourself by investing in those people. Out of nowhere, all of a sudden, a rabbi from Israel with Nachum came inside into the synagogue there. First time since I know them for so many years that they have somebody come to the lecture to raise funds. Never happened before, and I doubted if it will ever happen again. I don't know, for whatever reason, he brought them in the middle of the lecture. The place was packed. He got in. After I just finished 15 minutes of Musar about charity, he got in. And he doesn't even know a word in English. He comes to me, Mishamayim Hashem puts that I prepare the minds of the people for this tzaddik. And I know, I happen to know Hebrew. And right when he told me what he needs and what about his yeshiva, I translated everything. And everybody's heart was fuming, like boiling. Right away, one guy, 4,000, 4,000 for me, 4,000 for my sister, 4,000, maybe $30,000 he collected in a minute. He looked at me like this and said, wow. Three times I have to come from Israel to America to collect what I collected in a minute. Why do people open up their hearts so much? Because when the heart of a person hears Musar, he wakes up. That's why I always tell people, you want to get my advice? No matter what happened, you have to start your day with minimum 20 minutes of Musar. You finish praying in the morning, 20 minutes Musar. English, Hebrew, Russian, doesn't matter. Musar. What Musar means? Antibiotic, antibiotic to the soul. Your soul is numb, is sleeping, is already dying out. He needs a boost. How to start the day? You wake up. You read how bad you are. How many bad things you do every day. Sometimes you read about the punishments you're going to get. It wakes you up. I remember for the first time of my life when I read Masechet Gehenom. One time, a person gave me a book. I open up the book. I see the title. Masechet Gehenom. What does it mean? All the words of the Torah, the oral Torah, about hell. Everything. I say, there's something like this, Masechet Gehenom? He say, yeah. I don't think you should read it, he told me. I said, why? He said, believe me, you won't sleep after. When a person comes and give you a book, and you want to read it, and he say, I don't recommend you read it, because you won't sleep for a week, what do you do right away? What Adam did when Hashem told him, don't eat from the tree? You have millions of trees. The fool goes to one tree. What is this? The whole world is yours. You destroyed your eternity. Why? That's the way of a person. He give you a house with 60 bedrooms. Don't enter this room. The minute later, that's like the Chafetz Chaim. He wanted to publish something in town very fast. So he told his wife, you know, they didn't have internet. They didn't have Torah any time. You turn it on, 100,000 people will read your message. A Chafetz Chaim is 100 years ago. So he told his wife, call the two neighbors. She called up the two old ladies and he told them, I have something to tell you, but make sure you don't tell anyone. Please, make sure. It's very important not to tell anyone. I heard this and this about that guy. Okay, Rabbi, don't worry. Our lips are sealed. By the next day, everybody in town knew what he wanted them to know. Why? This is the way we are. I'll tell you a secret, but I want you to promise me never to tell anyone. Before you finish the sentence, you're already thinking, who do I tell first? So anyway, yeah. So come. And you know what? A murderer always have to tell somebody about what he did. It's interesting. That's how they get caught, a lot of them. You just killed someone, 2 years, nobody caught you. If he suffers until he tells someone. Why is it? It's interesting. There's a lot of interesting things. The Ramchal continues. The Ramchal says like this. HaKadosh Baruch Hu put a person around many enemies. He's surrounded with enemies. Now you may think enemies is his mother-in-law, his brother-in-law, his neighbor, the gabbai in a shul, the person who pays the salaries in the yeshiva. Those different kinds of enemies. The real enemies is time. Time is a real enemy. Why? Because you always think you're going to have time forever. It hardly moves. Time. Yeah, we have time. Slowly. Rabbi, don't be so fanatic. Ma, in 1 week you want me to be already a Chafetz Chaim? Okay. Started to tell you, when that guy gave me that book, I started to read Masechet Gehenom, maybe 30 or 40 pages, with all the sources of Chazal and the Zohar and the Gemara about what's happening over there. Then I started to see the names of all the angels, the names of all the places, description of the places, the color of the fires, for what scenes you go to what section, there are 7 different sections, mamash like a movie in Hollywood. But this time it's real. In a movie, you know, it's all an illusion. I tell you exactly what people goes where for what scenes. Mamash, with the names of everything. And names of people in history that went to certain places for what scene. And one time, once I read it, I felt like, I don't know, like my body is electrocuted. If I could that day, believe me, I would make 5,000 mitzvot a minute. Why? It woke me up, such a wake-up call. Then maybe 100 times I read it, until I knew every word there by heart. At one point in my life, many years ago, you could have started saying something, I would tell you the entire page. Why? There's no better wake-up call. When you read, God forbid, what can be the Chas v'Shalom, the end of a person that rebelled against his Creator, you don't want to get there. You learn it by heart. You don't want to get there. So one time it says like this. There was a righteous person that never made any sin in his life. Except one time he made one sin. Be'ezrat Hashem etzlenu in a day. One sin in a day, we in a good condition. Only one a day? All his life, one sin. What was the sin? You may think he ate pork. He, by mistake, made laundry on Shabbat. Or he wrote maybe by mistake a telephone number. You know what was his sin? One time in the yeshiva, a person gave a speech. And he gave a divrei chizuk from the Mishnah, Gemara. And he cut to us as a sentence from the Torah, and he forgot the words, the text. He got confused how the pasuk goes. And that person was sitting in a crowd, and somebody was about to continue the pasuk for that speaker, and he went like this, shh. That's his whole sin in his life. He went like this, shh. Don't tell him. Let's see if he knows by himself. That's all. One sin in his life. You know what was his punishment for that? When I read that, I started to shake. They brought him in front of heaven. God showed him all the righteous people of all the generations, what pleasure they get. And he said, let me in. So you cannot go in. And he doesn't know for how long now. They wrote that he did not know for how long. So once, after 40 days, that he was standing, it says over there in Reshit Chochmah, this is a book that a great Kabbalist wrote more than 450 years ago. Rav Vidaj, one of the biggest Mekubalim. He collected everything, all the sources, and made a book, Reshit Chochmah. Over there he brings it. So it says over there, for 40 days he was screaming with such agony and pain that he wants to go in. He cannot hold himself for what he sees over there. And only after 40 days they let him in. And that he says like this, for one sentence that he embarrassed his friend in front of the people. Once in a while, what's such stupidity? What did he gain by that? The guy got embarrassed for 2 seconds. 2 seconds. The guy got embarrassed. 40 days he lost from heaven. 40 days. And according to the time here, what do you see here? The Gemara says, Rabbi Yochanan one time saw Eliyahu Navi. He saw an image, person, he speaks to him, then he found out that it's Eliyahu Navi. Chazal had spiritual eyes. Many places in the Gemara you saw that Chazal had conversation with dead people or with angels. For instance, you see that some of the Chachamim writes that Eliyahu HaNavi came to speak to them. Rabbi Yehuda HaNasi, after he died, used to come to his wife every Friday night to make Kiddush in the house, even though he was dead already. His spirit came. I have in life after life people that saw people and spoke to people, and then later they found out that it was dead people. Remember the story, if you saw that lecture, you can see it on the website. There's Dr. Mitchell something, a girl in the middle of a snowing night. She knocks on his door. Come, doctor, save my mother. She's dying. In the middle of the night, the doctor sees snow. He felt bad for this girl. He comes to the mother. He cures the mother. He gives her the medicine and everything she needed. Then the doctor tells the mother, you're so lucky. You have such clever girl. Thanks to your girl's intelligence and wisdom, she knew how to find me. How did she know to come, to find me in my house and bring me over here to save you? The mother says to him, what girl are you talking about? My girl died 2 months ago. So he says, she's opened up the drawer over here. This is the only souvenir I got for her. Her clothes, her scarf, it's right here in the drawer. He opened up the drawer, he almost fainted. The clothes that the girl was wearing when she came to call him was right here in the drawer. And the girl died. A spirit. It's happened. There's another guy that his son got murdered in the Navy. He started to come and speak to him in an image. He's whispering in his ear, my body is in the trunk of a car. Drive, I'm going to show you where it is. Drive here, drive there, drive there. He showed him a car in 7-Eleven, standing there in the parking. My body is right here in the trunk. Call the police. Comes the police. He calls up the police. My son got murdered. I found out the body. Police comes, open up the trunk. The two people come out of the 7-Eleven. They see police. They open up the trunk. His son is in the body, in a trunk. Yeah, a lot of stories like this that were clarified. Many. I don't remember. I have to look up in a computer. But you can see it on Torah anytime. I bring it over there. I have Life After Life in English, in Hebrew. Chazal is at least 2,000 years ago. Gemara says, Rabbi Yochanan say, Pam achat pagashti et Eliyahu Navi. I found Eliyahu Navi. And he told me like this. Retzoncha sha'amitcha al pitcha shel gehenom. You want me to take you to a tour to see hell? To see what happened to the people who rebelled against God and didn't care about the Torah? Amarti lohen. I say yes. And he started to describe, I don't want to depress you, but he said he started to take me to each place and each section and show me how the ladies get punished because their body were not modest. They did not wear the proper things. And he started to describe what they got. Then he took him to another section and he saw that angels are forcing people to eat beach sand. And their teeth are breaking to pieces, full of blood, and they scream, and they move their head, and they hear the echo of God speaking. Wicked people, when you ate stolen food all your life, it was sweet in your mouth. Now you refuse to eat? That's what Rabbi Yochanan described. That's what he saw in a vision. Rabbi Akiva, one time Rabbi Akiva walked in the street, and he see a person burned. His clothes are burned. He's holding trees on his back and he walk. And Rabbi Akiva say, hey, excuse me, sir, can I help you? He say, no, you can't help me. Very depressed. Nobody can help me. I'm finished. Why come? Let me help you. Then after a few minutes that Rabbi Akiva speaks to him, he realizes that he's a dead person. It's a spirit. See an image of a spirit person. It's a dead person. So he told him, why you got such punishment? You carry such heavy things on your tree and you all burned out. So he told him, because I never learned Torah, I lived like a goy in my life. That's my punishment. What's the punishment? He has to take trees from one place and pick it up all the way up to the mountain. And then when he's finished, he has to go and bring more, and it never ends. So Rabbi Akiva say, you have to have children, no? Maybe you have a son. Why your son doesn't say Kaddish on you, something to help you out? He said, my son is worse than me. It's mamash like a goy. Rabbi Akiva told him, where is your son? Tell me where he lives. He said, don't waste your time. He doesn't know to read even. He said, no, tell me his place. Felt bad for him. So he told him the name of the town. Gemara said, Rabbi Akiva, greater than Moshe Rabbeinu, the greatest Jew in history. Rabbi Akiva, because of the emergency, left his learning, left everything, went to that town to look for his son. When he got to that town, he started to ask people, where is this Mr. X living? Everybody said, Shem Rashaim Irkav, don't mention the name of this Rasha. Whoa, Rabbi Akiva, you want to speak to this filthy person? Rabbi Akiva said, yes, I have something to do with him. Tell me where he is. Finally, he found that person, no keeper, no nothing, lives like mamash, like a goy. Rabbi Akiva comes to him and started to speak to him, describe his father to him, what's his father, how much his father suffering because of him. So he is the only one can help his father. The Gemara says, Bra mezake av. A son can help his father spirit. That's it. If he goes and does mitzvot for him, he helps him out. He elevates him. He eases his punishment if he was wicked. Rabbi Akiva took him and started to teach him Aleph Bet. Aleph Bet, to read, to say Kaddish, to learn Mishnayot. Then Rabbi Akiva saw that dead person coming to him. Wah, God bless you, he saved me. I had a woman in New Jersey. I will say her name in front of the camera, that you'll know it's legit, you can verify it. His name is Agi Ratinsky. A woman, she and her husband wasn't religious. They started to come to the lectures, Baruch Hashem, today. They're fully religious. But one time she comes to me and she said that when she wasn't religious, she didn't do anything for her father. She feels bad. She heard that the children can help their parents after they died. So I told her, I have a solution for you. Nobody say Kaddish on him, nothing. Her brother is not religious. Nobody say Kaddish on her father. So I told her, you cannot say Kaddish. Have some money, whatever you can afford. We'll give it to a guy in yeshiva that says Kaddish. We'll say Kaddish for 1 year for your father. She said, you think it's going to help? I say, yes. We're going to say for the memory of your, for Leilui Nishmat, your father. And 2-3 months later, Friday morning, 11 o'clock in the morning, I drive in West Maple in Monsey. I get to the light, I get a phone call. I look at the phone, New Jersey. Area code New Jersey. I pick up the phone. She's all shaking on the phone. Don't ask. What? Last night my father came to me in a dream. Ah, you saved me. God bless you. You saved me. I feel so much better. She's all shaking. She's like, oh, I can't believe it. Somebody say Kaddish. 2-3 months, not even. One professor, the Dr. Rubinstein, the famous Dr. Rubinstein, one of the best doctors in the world. He invented the word HIV, AIDS, in 1981. The first doctor that named the AIDS disease. He is the one who made up the name. He is the head of Einstein Hospital in Bronx. Until today, he's an expert for blood diseases. Very famous doctor, one of the most famous doctors in the world today. I had the merit to do 2 or 3 seminars with him many years ago. He was giving a lecture about AIDS, showing how AIDS is moving mamash like God's plan. His smart virus, how he modified himself every time you attack him, how he knows how to hide. Cannot be nature. Mamash like a human being. Clever, hide, run around, change his custom. Halloween. Every 2 hours, he becomes something else. You attack him with minus A, he becomes B. You go minus B, he becomes C. He says, based on that, he started to become religious. Today, he lives in Muncie. He works with Yamaka in a hospital. So he said that when he wasn't religious, his father died. He didn't even say Kaddish, nothing. Then, when he was religious, his mother died. So he started to say Kaddish on his mother. After a few months that he said Kaddish on his mother, he says, my father came to me in a dream and say, Arye, I'm not your father, you only had a mother. So why, what happened? 17 years after he's dead. 17 years. Say, so I know how much I suffer for the way I've been. You don't want to help me also? So what should I do? So help me also. Came to the Rav. So my father died 17 years ago. What can I do for him after 17 years? Kaddish is saying the first year. The Rav told him, start saying Kaddish on him and learn Mishnayot for his memory. For his Ilui Nishmat. Memory is not the right word. To remember the dead people doesn't help them. To do something to elevate their soul, it helps them. After a few months, he came to him half black, half white. In a dream. Don't stop. I'm much better, but don't stop. There's still a way to go. I have hundreds of stories like this from people that I know personally. I can write a book just from the stories I heard about souls and dreams and people that died and came, include myself. My wife just made a shidduch a few weeks ago. 2 Ashkenazi guys. One guy is a very big Talmid Chacham. He's 20 years old, finished the Shas 5 times already. The only one in the world that nobody can do it. In age 20, finished the Shas. 4 times Shas Bavli, 1 time Shas Yerushalmi. 5 times, age 20. Such a nice person with midot. One of the Gdolei Ador for the future to come. She made a shidduch between him and another righteous girl. Bezrat Hashem, next week, the engagement. But the parents of the guy had so many doubts and so many investigations and worry. And, you know, it's not a regular guy. They got so nervous. Then one morning, I'm about to leave the house. My wife tells me, the parents of the guy, find out if the father or the mother are Hungarian. I said, why? So I'm telling you, an Hungarian rabbi came to me in a dream and told me, you made a very good, fantastic shidduch. Don't be upset from all the problems. everything will work out. That was a few weeks ago when everything looks very shaky because they want to cancel it, they're not sure, you didn't supply us what we want, all kinds of yetzer hara. I call up that guy, the father of the Chatan. Tell me, by any chance you or your wife is Hungarian? He's starting to laugh. He said, we both Hungarian. So I started to describe him the person. Told him a person with beard like this, bald, blue eyes, glasses. You know, he came to my wife and she asked him, who are you? He told him that it's a very good shidduch. And she asked him, who are you? He said, I'm from Hungary. And that's it. And she woke up. So before I describe him the way he looks, he started to scream on the phone. Wow, Hashem will help me. Not only a shatchan I have to deal with, which is already a problem, a Sephardic shatchan that makes a shidduch based on dreams. I'm a lost case. He screams on the phone. You know, they make fun of the Sephardim that they go by dreams, by all kinds of things. Then when I started to describe the man, he goes like this, wow, it's my grandfather. It's his grandfather. No. Then I went to L.A. I'll never forget that. That Friday morning, he calls me up. I want to let you know the shidduch is over. You're going to find the right way how to do it. I said, well, what can I do? In New York, it was already Shabbat. There's nobody to call. I'm in L.A. I said, no, I don't know. Dreams, the Gemara says sometimes the dream is correct, sometimes not. Maybe it's an illusion. I don't know. Motzei Shabbos in New York, it's already Motzei Shabbos for 3 hours. First moment, Shabbat is finished, I call up my wife. I call my wife, I see she's all happy on the phone. I say, well, what's going on over there? I hear noise. She say, well, you call in the right time. Here, speak to your friend. She gave me the phone, they're sitting in my house, finishing the shidduch, the parents. Just a few hours before Shabbat, he told me it's over, everything turned around. So I told my wife, the truth is, I already knew once you had that dream, she had one dream before the shidduch, one once when before it finished, that it's a message from Shammai. But you never know, there's always an unexpected things. But now you see, Mishamayim. The dreams and neshamot and all these things, it's 100%. 100%. You have so many hundreds of things. Let's finish. Almost the time is running out. Boy, it ran out already. Let me steal 5 more minutes and finish what I wanted to finish. Then the Ramchal continues and says like this. When a person becomes a complete person after he's stuck to his creator all the time, he's gonna go out of the hallway and enter the living room, which means the Olam Haba, the world to come. If you're gonna review the world carefully, you will see that the entire world was created for the main use. And the world can be used in 2 ways, for your benefit and to destroy you, one of the two. Depend what are you going to choose. If a person does not pay attention to what's happening with him, he is getting spoiled and also spoiling the world of God. But if he controlled himself and stick to his creator and use the materialistic world only as assistant to reach his target, money, how do I get close to Hashem with this money? Car? What do I do now to satisfy my creator? Food, how do I eat? Like a monkey or like a Jew? How do I get married? How do I live with my wife? How do I raise my children? How do I walk on the street? How do I talk to people that stole my money? How do I react? How do I behave in court? How do I behave in traffic? How do I behave when I speak to a goy? Millions of things in life. Without the Torah, the Gemara says, "Amar Rabbi Yochanan, Gemara in Maseret Eruvin, in Male Nitna Torah, Hainu Lomdim Derech Eretz Me'achatul V'atarnegol." If we, the Jews, would not get the Torah from Hashem, we would have to learn manners, how to behave from the rooster and from the cat. What do you learn? What do you learn from this? That we would be worse than the animals. Because when he goes to the bathroom, he covers it. Go to Lexington Avenue every day. You see some people standing in the middle of a million people. The bathroom is right there in the middle of the train for him. Yeah. That guy that I told you in the beginning that went to jail, he got to a place in the first, once he got there, he sees people laying down, drunk people, people with scars, people with blood. So laying down, they make the bathroom because they don't take you to the bathroom over there. You scream until tomorrow, I need bathroom, bathroom, they don't care. So the people make it on the floor, over there in the middle of the room. And some of them are so drunk that they later fall into it. That's what happens when you don't have Torah. You become worse than the cat and the rooster. And the Ramchal says, when Hashem created Adam, He took him to all the trees in heaven, Gan Eden, Garden of Eden, and say to him, it's all secrets, but let's try to understand something from it. See how beautiful is my creation? Everything I created in this world, I created for you. Make sure you don't ruin my world. What we learn from it? This is the final word for tonight, and this is what you remember, it's enough. One sentence. Adam lo nivra ba'avur matzavo ba'olam hazeh. A person was not created for his situation in this physical world. Ela ba'avur matzavo ba'olam haba. He was created to live forever in the world to come, without the body, without the physical world. Over there forever and ever. But he cannot get to that place before he goes to, you know what we say in Hebrew? Tironut. You know what Tironut is? How do you say Tironut in English? Huh? Training. Training, it's a soft word. Tironut, that means you eat garbage over there. Crawl on the thorns, on the floor. That's Tironut in 120 degrees. No, when you get to the army, if you want to be a parachuter, right? What do you think? You join the army, you come with your hair and everything, you come from mommy with the sandwiches from home, with a cell phone, you become a parachuter. Right away they catch you from your, hey, you, come right away to the barber. If you have money on you, you bribe the barber not to shave your head completely. The barbers in the army are the richest guys, you know, because they have hundreds of soldiers every day, and all these soldiers, they want to look nice. They don't want to shave head, you know. Today it's in fashion to have bald hair, but in the, when I was a soldier, forget it. People will give everything they can for the barber to have mercy on them. So now if you don't give him enough tip, he makes half a head very short, half a head very long. Then you come, you look at the mirror and say, you fool, what did you do? Say, you only gave me $5. Give me another $5, I do the other half. The Ramchal says, God did not created you for this world. That's why, what we learn from here? That 99.99999% of the people in this world living in a lie. They do not know what they're doing here. They have a dream, I'll live here forever. I'll buy another house and another vacation and another plane and another company, and I'm gonna do this and I'm gonna buy that and I'm gonna change the car and we go on vacation and we buy new clothes. All his efforts for this nonsense. Then he dies. God said, well, 70 years I gave you? You know how much money that 70 years cost? What did you do with that? You ate turkey once a year. Beautiful. Let's clap for this guy. Once a year he ate turkey. You ate leathers full of millions of worms every lunch. Then, no Shabbat, no charity, no Torah, no knowledge, no children education, no marriage. Nothing. Rich, nothing. Remember what the Goy said in the life after life lecture? Goy, that died and came back to life. The Goy testified. They showed me all my life. Every minute of my life I saw in those few minutes that I was dead. And I felt that I did not reach anything in my life. I did not fulfill one thing in my life. I failed in everything I did. I was so embarrassed. I felt I wish I can go back and restart all over again and correct and do it completely different. I felt that I'm a complete loser, nothing. I achieved nothing. A goy! How much he has to do? 7 laws. 7 laws. 6 from the 7 laws that God told the goyim, the dogs also keep. Yes, it's the way of nature. Only one, or maybe, you know, maybe I should be more precise. 5 of them, the dogs also keep. So 2, you have to a little bit put some efforts to keep. 2! 2 that you may not know that you have to do it. 2 mitzvot. You know what? Say 7. 7 mitzvot the goy had to do. He felt he achieved nothing. The Ramchal say, remember, the purpose, the direction, the target that you have to aim is only for the world of eternity, not for here. And this is what the Torah says, Ayom la'asotam, today to do, and tomorrow to receive your reward. And if the more you use the intelligence that God gave you, you see that the people around you are full of sorrow and weak and sicknesses and pain, and they are bothered with so many problems and agonies, and then they died. And whatever supposedly they reach you anyway, most of it they did not enjoy. You won't find 1 out of 1,000 people that is happy in this world. Unless if he's a fool. Because people that are mental, they smile all the time sometimes. Because they are disconnected from reality. You know, also babies. You saw babies? The baby, they never worry about the mortgage. They don't worry if they don't feel good. Chas v'shalom, you go to the cancer section of the children, in moments that they don't have physical pain, they smile, you bring them a clown, they're happy, they have only 1 month to live. But they don't understand that, because they're very young. The older they get, the more their brain develops. The parents crying behind the curtain over there. But they're smiling. And this is what the Torah says, Yemesh notenu baem 70 shana. We're going to live here 70 years. In bigvurot 80 shana. If you're lucky, you got a bonus. 80 years. Verochbam amal va'aven. Full of agony and efforts and pain and sorrow. Kama mine tzar. The Ramchal said, 1 out of 1,000 cannot raise his hand and say, I feel that my life was great, perfect. No, IRS, investigation, arrest, divorce. You know how many divorce cases you have in the Jewish world? Almost every second house have a war for years about divorce. How many miserable people cannot see their children? How many people are in hospitals from morning to night, lose their job for 3 months? They lose their houses. Why? They have one baby that born with a problem. How many, 15% of the Jews are barren, cannot have children. They have to spend fortune and fly to Israel, to Belgium, to all kinds of cheap places, because here it's very expensive. For maybe sometimes 12, 15 years, until finally they get a kid. And then when they finally have the kid, 20 years later, he's going to send them to old age home. And pray when they're going to die that I can take their money. That's this world. We're laughing, but that's the truth. Yeah.
Question. You've mentioned on many of your lectures about studying Mishnayot for relatives who passed away.
Right. That's the best learning.
I come from
a... Mishnah Otiyot Neshama. Same letters.
So my question is, I come from a family of wonderful, wonderful people, but we're not observant, and I'm very interested in doing
such
that.
A contradiction in one sentence.
Two sentences, very important. Do they count as Mishnayot?
Yes.
Okay. B, let's say I wanted a list of all the relatives I know that have passed away that I want to study for. Do I say a specific prayer to tell Hashem that I'm learning for their neshamot, for their welfare?
Once in your life you can say. When you start learning, you say, I'm learning for A, B, C, D. You don't have to repeat it every day.
If I don't know their Hebrew names, can I use their...
Their English names. Hashem knows them, don't worry. Okay. He know Howard, he know Vinny, he know Johnny, he know Matthew.
Matthew.
He know Chris Cohen. Believe me, I know a guy like this, Chris Cohen. What can he do that he had a foolish father? Huh? Anthony Weiner? Well, Anthony, every Anthony wants to be a winner, you know, so.
And what about Kaddish? If you went to a
yes.
You know, I'll give you some money. Can you recite Kaddish for these lists?
Yes. I have my brother in yeshiva that says Kaddish for maybe by now, I believe, more than 20 names.
Does he know, like, how to express the intent for these people?
No, once when he gets the money, they pay for the entire year with the name of the person. He says, my Kaddish will be also for this person, for the entire year, from now until next year. That's it. Every time he says...
For that
we say, the more we say, the better it is. In yeshiva, it's good, because all day you say kaddishim. In shachrit, mincha, arvit, when you finish the learning, after, I mean, in breakfast, when someone say dvar Torah. So there's many kaddishim in yeshiva, more than any other place. Understand? So the more you say, the better it is. There's no set price. You earn two things here. First, you support a guy that sits and learns more than 10 hours Torah every day, and teach Torah. So even without the Kaddish, it's a huge mitzvah, because you become a partner for Torah, which is the best investment in this life. Plus, you're helping all these people, so you kill two birds with one stone. It's a very good investment. I give you an example. This woman that I was telling you about from Jersey, she gave 100 or 150, I'm not sure, every month. And they say at least 15, 20 times a day for Erev Kaddish. Plus, they learn Mishnayot for his Neilui Neshama. Not only the Kaddish. They learn, they say the Mishnayot, we learn now in the next 2 hours for the list of these people. And just since you mentioned it, my brother was the one who said Kaddish for the father of this lady that she came, she called that morning, all nervous, that her father started to say to her that she saved him and all that. Yeah. Interesting, you know. They went, I mean, sometimes you meet people, when I meet them, they do not know one little thing of Judaism. But so amazing, after 2-3 months, you come again to that place and you see that they all, thanks to the wonders of the internet, you know, yes, the guys, they get 100 lectures from the website, they put it on their palm or iPad. On the way with the train, they go to Manhattan, let's say 40 minutes in the morning, 40 minutes, you have about an hour and something. Every day almost you can finish a lecture. It's very good. It counts of learning Torah. Especially when it's Musar, it wakes you up. Because when you hear me screaming in your headphones, you don't want to look at the ladies in the train. So you kill two birds with one stone. You're learning Torah, plus you're watching your eyes. Right? Thank you very much. Good night.